It's real bad here. It's real grey. I mean, look around you. What kind of colours are there?
A lot has changed over the last 10 years, but one thing that hasn't is a crisis on our high streets. This, it seems, is a story on loop, with images of closures, layoffs and empty shop fronts playing on repeat. But if the high street is dying, what does that mean for a place's sense of self-worth? And how do people imagine a future when all that's around them are empty shop fronts and the most likely prospect of sustainable work is a delivery depot? The cliched image of Britain's economy over the last decade is the London skyline, consumers on high streets and news reporters and analysts pointing to graphs going up or more often down. But that's only a fragment of the overall picture, with the decline of Britain's high street unfolding beyond the view of much of a political and media class whose mental landscape, and mostly physical one too, is disproportionately shaped by our most prosperous city. That's why we're going to two places on the south coast, Portsmouth and Bournemouth, to look at what's happening to the high street there and what happens to a place's sense of self-worth when its centre is increasingly identikit and host to ever more empty shop fronts.
You go down our high street and you pass six empty shops before you get one open, and then another six, and then you might get a pound shop, and then that's it, just down to the banks.
If there's a ground zero for the collapse of Britain's biggest retailers, Palmerston Road and the South Sea area of Portsmouth is it. There was once a Debenhams department store opposite John Lewis, but they've both gone over the last couple of years. The John Lewis had been there since 1937, its predecessor department store since the 1870s. I met up a few miles away in the city centre with Cal Corkery, a councillor for the area and a housing officer, to learn more about how things have changed in recent years.
So this is Charlotte Street, and for a long time the Charlotte Street Market was the real kind of hub of commercial activity in the city centre. The shops that are still here cater just to the low end of the market, your kind of classic cut price 99p shops. You've got the big brands, a lot of them have moved out and have been replaced by secondhand phone shops or kind of 99p shops at the budget end of the market.
I mean, our main product is really accessories, which is phone accessories. You know, even we feel the heat, to be honest. All we hear from customers like, oh, my money's not enough, I'll think about it. Or they go, probably they buy online because £2 to £3 cheaper, which is true. But for us, we have seen this as a feedback that they actually, you know, don't have enough money to spend.
Would you be willing to pay £2 or £3 more for something like a book or a piece of clothing if it's offline?
Personally, yes.
Yeah. If you buy something and you have a problem, I want to go back to where I bought it.
Yeah, you want to deal with people, whereas it's often difficult when you buy something online. But then again, we've both got jobs and we're not on the breadline. You know, from a different people's perspective, you've got to look at it from both angles.
This was something I repeatedly heard when we interviewed people. Most people prefer buying things locally and enjoy the experience of going out and talking to others. High streets don't seem to be struggling necessarily because of footfall, but because people, by and large, just haven't got the cash to spend. As I found out, this has an often ignored impact on council funding, particularly in the context of austerity.
Over the last decade or so, as austerity has been pushed on local authorities, grants from local government, from central government to local government, have been cut massively. I think it's kind of 70 to 80% in a lot of places. Portsmouth's no different. One of the ways in which the government is trying to make up for that in terms of funding for councils is by making them more reliant on business rates, which in one sense is a positive, because previously most of the business rates went to central government. However, what that then means is that there's a kind of catch-22 attention between setting business rates at an affordable level and a way in which it also makes it viable for local businesses to want to come here and set up shop.
So the less money from central government, the more dependent on business rates, the bigger the incentive to have high business rates, but then of course that means more empty shop fronts most likely.
Exactly, yeah. So it's a real tension, and I think it's one of the big issues facing the high street today.
You have business rate, you have tax, you have VAT, you have so much. So it's hard to survive like that. It really is. If you want the local business to survive, they should really have coordination with the shareholders or the landlords, that, you know, rather having the store shut for like years, 3 years, 4 years, give it a price or, you know, a lease that tenants can survive in it.
These beaches were where the Allied forces set off in 1944 ahead of the D-Day landings, but the area itself, Southsea, was and remains a seaside destination of sorts, although some of the Victorian grandeur has somewhat faded. Nevertheless, the area adapted even after suffering significant bombing during the Second World War. But the most recent challenge appears to be the most difficult, and like much of Britain, it's unclear what the identity of the place really is. Independents are trying, there are charity shops and cafes, but generally speaking, retail, which employs huge numbers of people in Britain, is struggling.
The M&S is still empty.
Yeah, you can only go to so many pound shops on a trip into town.
This is Rich White. He's the political officer for Unite the Union in the southeast of England. And for him, the decline of the high street in Portsmouth goes hand in hand with the decline of manufacturing.
Portsmouth used to be sort of a northern industrial town on the south coast. It's just waning. It's not here anymore. There's elements of it, but it's in decline. Back in 2013, shipbuilding ceased in Portsmouth as well. Another area we've got shopping-wise is Gun Wharf, which used to be HMS Vernon, which was geared up towards submarines and torpedoes. And also the setup of the road infrastructure coming into Portsmouth has changed in a way that they filter traffic into Gun Wharf to shop, and then for people to filter out of Gun Wharf again, they don't actually come into Portsmouth. I think that the whole infrastructure of the way Portsmouth's laid out is channeling people into those areas where you've got jobs at a minimum wage, precarious employment, and all that money being spent there is just being sucked back out of the city again.
Is that my bus? No.
It's your bus?
For our older ones that don't drive, everything's out of town. And it's a job to get to unless you get family and they're working all the week. So it does make me sad.
And this lunchtime, time has run out for Portsmouth's Tricorn building. It's being knocked down to make way for a new and hopefully prettier development. Chris, are the good people of Portsmouth rejoicing in the streets today?
This is one piece of concrete that hasn't stood the test of time.
This whole car park was the Tricorn Centre. At that time, brutalism wasn't in fashion.
It's just not pleasant, is it? And you just think it's about time.
Monstrosity building! Get it down!
Councillor Jackson, you're going to knock it down. What are you going to put there in its place?
We're going to recreate the shops, the streets, the homes that used to be here before the Luftwaffe destroyed it and get rid of this terrible, terrible building. I think it's a great thing. This has been empty for 10 years. First year of Liberal Democrats running this city of Portsmouth. We're getting rid of this and we're going to have a good, traditional, vibrant street scene back here. Decent shops, decent homes and good streets, and I think it's absolutely wonderful.
Obviously 2008 hit, that all went down the Swanee, so to speak. Yeah, I think this is one of the kind of running sores in the local psyche. I think people have probably really given up having any hopes that it will be redeveloped. Nobody wants to do anything permanent or long term in a city centre because they're so unsure about what the future of the area is going to be. The consecutive failed regeneration projects have led to a lot of people just giving up and thinking that nothing's going to happen here or nothing's going to happen here anytime soon. So yeah, a lot of people do feel quite dejected and kind of pessimistic about the future of the area.
There have always, of course, been ups and downs to the high street. Yet over the last 15 years, it's become clear that something else is happening. The financial crash of 2008, firing a starting gun for decline whose causes are changing shopping habits, the internet, out-of-town shopping centres, and the fact wages have been squeezed for more than a decade. This was all before COVID-19, which has seemingly accelerated and exacerbated this preceding trend. This is an important distinction to make. COVID isn't responsible for the death of the high street, but is without any shadow of a doubt accelerating pre-existing trends. I have a confession to make. I'm from Bournemouth. That flat there is where I lived for the first 10 years of my life, right in the middle of town. It was a great place to grow up and very different to today. This is Corrie Drew. She was the Labour candidate for Bournemouth East in the 2019 general election. She moved to Bournemouth around the same time I left to go to university in London.
Bournemouth is quite dazzling when I first moved here, and there certainly weren't empty shop units. The heart seems to be going out of it, and I think the pandemic potentially is going to really put the nail in the coffin. I think this is a real snowball effect with high streets, because obviously the less money there is coming in for the shops and the businesses, and also for the councils, the less there is to put into the area, and it starts to look a little scruffy. And over time, all of that builds, and eventually it's not a nice place for people to go and spend their time.
This here is Mohamed Bagher, or Mamad for short. He's my dad, and he's been living in Bournemouth since the 1970s. He's been a taxi driver in the town for 20 years and knows the place as well as anyone else. His views on what the future holds for the town, particularly in the context of COVID-19, are particularly grim.
That's shut. All of them are shut. I feel many of the businesses won't come back. This is my personal opinion. Many of businesses won't come back. Many of the taxi drivers have given up, and they are doing parcel delivery. They are doing takeaway delivery because they earn more money by doing a takeaway delivery than driving a taxi. People used to come down Bournemouth for shopping. They need taxi. For football, they need a taxi. And the student, they used to go out at night. They need a taxi to go back. Now we don't have students going out. There is no shopping and there is no football. So there is no business. Us as a taxi, we probably about quarter of our taking is purely students. I think we have about 23,000 students in two universities. And if you take the account, they get £5,000 grant. Apart from the parents' money, that is £110 million. And that is just a grant, apart from the parents helping their children.
Yeah.
And that money basically was being spent in
local economy.
In local economy, £110 million. And without a student, this town will never be the same.
This is really interesting. Dad says business was good until COVID, but cites students and Bournemouth being a Premier League club as two reasons why. Which got me thinking, has the expansion of HE, higher education, and ever-rising student tower blocks to some extent mitigated the collapse of retail on the high street?
I think on the road just past the train station, I think there's over 4,000 students living on that small piece of road now. You know, the council have to provide services for that as well, you know, in terms of doctors, hospitals, there's you know, buses, things like that. It all puts pressure on other services round about. It's a huge amount of people that have concentrated in a small area.
Like, I come here knowing that Portsmouth is more of like a city-wide university, so
it does feel like a bit like a campus though, because we know, because we're staying in the accommodation literally just there, so it's kind of like we always bump into people we know, so it kind of seems as a campus uni when actually it's a city.
All of these are new within the last 5 years.
So this is basically the market without any constraints, isn't it? This is purely about maximising profit. It's not about building apartments because students need them the most. It's actually about, well, this just happens to make the most money and it has the least regulatory oversight.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, this is market-led development at its core. What I think is one of the kind of key factors here is that there hasn't really been a plan around how the city centre would develop. So the failed public regeneration schemes around the Tricorn have led to a situation where developers have been able to come in and do whatever they find is most profitable without really any barriers or kind of requirements put in their way.
So it feels like that even though you've got issues with the decline of the high street, problems with retail, that the expansion of higher education, the university here in Portsmouth, as with elsewhere, it feels like it's mitigating those problems. But, and here's the big question, I guess, now in the context of COVID, if that disappeared, if the university had to shut down for 6 months or a year, if the international students stopped coming, what kind of implications do you think that would have for Portsmouth as a city economically?
If student numbers drop off, and in particular if international student numbers drop off, then I think the developers that own these buildings are going to have real financial issues. And then there's going to be the question about what they do with those buildings. There are developers now who are saying we can't fill these buildings with students, so therefore we need to convert them to private residential accommodation. And we know with the planning policies as they are, what that allows them then to do is to sidestep any social housing obligation that they would have originally been faced if they built it as private housing, but also space standards, one of those other things that are going to go out of the market. So we potentially face a quite a serious issue with these being then converted further down the line into substandard private accommodation.
What Cal tells me here is revealing, and shows the interconnectedness not only between the changing nature of the high street and the expansion of higher education, but also housing. Students living off loans are paying to live in these places and keeping many high streets in somewhat suspended animation. If that changes, particularly with COVID, these same buildings could be the future of much private rental accommodation, an area which seems to only get worse. A failing system on debt, higher education, high streets and housing all appears to be deeply interconnected. But could something else happen? Is there a plausible alternative? Do our city centres have to be like this? For some, the answer is leaning into the cultural industries and making town centres more appealing as destinations in their own right. For others, the end of the high street is every bit as big a challenge as the collapse of manufacturing over recent decades. But what's unanimous is a general status quo. The high street as it is utterly dysfunctional.